He is currently working as assistant professor in D.Y. Patil International University, Akrodi, Pune. Earlier, he has worked as a founder and CEO, Moonsuits cum expert engineer on AI, cloud, big data. He has worked with Nike, big data cloud analytics developer in Monosend company. He has a vast experience in various industries and institutes such as Rackspace, then University of Florida, GX Technologies. So we say that the professor Yon said, our intelligence is what makes us human, and AI is an extension of that quality. So sir is going to today talk on importance of AI for future humanities. So I request now Dr. Obulpati sir to take over the session.
Thank you, Jyoti ji. Let me share my screen. Okay, can you all see my screen?
Yes, sir.
It's yes, visible.
So we get started. So, hello everybody. My name is Dr. Naidu, and today I'm going to talk about importance of AI. I think Dr. Jyoti has already introduced about me, so I'm not going to talk about much about myself. So mostly we're going to look at what is artificial intelligence and what is the importance of AI for the future of humanity. To kind of give you more context, I'm going to talk about few AI applications, sort of end it with what sort of implications AI has, and both ethical implications as well as societal, economical, etc. So if you ask what is artificial intelligence, can think of artificial intelligence as building these systems that are intelligent. And when I say that are intelligent, that doesn't mean they need to solve a complicated formula. It might be as simple as looking at a picture and explaining what is in that picture, or even walking, running, jumping, imagining something, being afraid of something. That's also a very important aspect of intelligence, and even appreciating beauty, to all these things that a human being is capable of, those are called intelligent, those are intelligent behaviors. And when we build these systems, that's called artificial intelligence. And so normally,
sir, can you please switch your PPTs to slideshow mode?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sure.
Thank you.
So before I learn something, I always ask this question, why should I learn this? What is the importance of this thing? Now I'm sure you are all aware, if you take a look at the global scenario, the kind of challenges that we are facing are pretty enormous, coming from climate change to extinction of several species. We now make about 5 to 6 species go extinct every day, to scenarios like COVID-19. These challenges are pretty huge, and we are already at the boundary of human intelligence when it comes to tackling these very complex problems. That's where we need the help of AI. And if you can research, and the goal is if you can research and build the safe AI systems that can learn how to solve these complex problems, that will be a game changer for humanity. So when we think about AI, I want you to think about what fire or electricity has done to humanity, how many benefits they have bought. So before fire, human life was vastly different versus after fire. And now today, we cannot think about a life without electricity. Everything that lives, that's surrounding us, depends on electricity. The same way, I believe artificial intelligence is going to be a game changer for humanity, and it does change your, it has a huge potential to change your life by solving these huge challenges. And some of them we are going to look at in this presentation. So I'm going to give a brief animation about how AI works. So imagine these are, what is shown on the screen is sort of this is called a neural network, and these are neurons. And this artificial intelligence is loosely inspired by the way our brain works. So that's why these, like, you know, the fundamental units are called neurons, and you can see the connections between the neurons. Our goal here is very simple. Our goal here is to train this neural network to differentiate between these orange dots and a blue dot. So given these XY coordinates, our goal is to say, like, you know, hey, this is a blue dot versus this is an orange dot. So I'm going to start, like, you know, and then you can think of this as like a newborn baby. Let's see how it learns. You can see that these weights are evolving, and some of them became strong, some of them became weak. And now the neural network is capable of differentiating between, like, you know, where a blue dot falls versus like where a orange dot falls. So you can see, like, you know, I want you to watch a couple of things. One is, like, you know, how this picture here evolves. Initially, if you make it, like, you know, here, the model is like very ambiguous in the sense it doesn't know what a blue dot is, what a red dot is. So the foreground color tells which one is which, but the background color tells you, like, what the model thinks. Here the model thinks that there is a faint blue over here. So it thinks, like, you know, all these things are blue dots versus, like, you know, things that fall here are the red dots. And another thing that I want you to watch is, like, how these connections evolve over time. Essentially, like, you know, we say, like, you know, hey, that guy is, like, wired like that. So what it means is that the neurons in the brain, they are connected in a different way. So these neurons initially are, like, randomly initialized. And when we start training this machine learning model or building this machine learning model, they sort of, like, evolve to predict a certain pattern. So I'm clicking on the animation. So watch these two things, how the connections evolve and how these patterns evolve. So this is what I mean by, like, you know, when I say, like, building a machine learning model, though this machine learning model is very simple, which is, like, you know, classifying this orange robot, which sort of, like, you know, they're saying, like, it's kind of like a humanoid robot, to Google Home, Alexa, to driverless cars, and some of the pivotal moments in the history of AI is the AlphaGo game, where AI won against human mind while playing the possibly the most complex structured game, which is AlphaGo, or which is Go. But if you look around you today, AI itself manifests in, like, hundreds of different ways. I'm sure you have used Amazon, Netflix, to Gmail, etc. So these are all powered by AI. If you look at, like, now, let's specifically, like, you know, dive down into some of these applications and see how each of these companies uses AI. So if you log in, when you log in into Amazon, every pixel that you see on Amazon, every pixel that you see on the screen is powered by AI. So coming from, like, you know, when you search for something, like, it uses a search term and it uses a machine learning model to figure out what you actually mean. To what products should be shown to you, again, is based on, you know, AI. To even, like, you know, to some extent, the prices that are even shown to you is based on AI. And when you order, like, you know, what you have ordered, like, you know, what should, like, the next products be, all those is, like, you know, is being done by AI. And when you make a comment, a lot of AI also comes into picture, like, you know, immediately AI comes into picture to see whether there's, like, any profanity in that, is the comment, like, you know, shown, is the comment, like, you know, safe, or, like, sometimes, like, when I used to work at, like, Nike, if somebody writes a comment on a product, then whether that comment, if that comment has, like, relevancy to certain team, immediately that comment will be routed to that particular team so that they can take action on that. Ads also bought, even, like, you know, pictures, let's say, like, you know, different people looking at the same product might even see different pictures. So every aspect of this Amazon website is driven by AI. So in the sense, like, you know, Amazon is an AI first company. And when it comes to Netflix, I'm sure, like, you know, with the COVID-19 and all the theaters, like, you know, getting closed, Netflix is getting, like, huge popularity, and its valuation is, like, soaring. It's about, like, you know, I believe it's more than, like, it's about, like, $200 billion. So when you log in into Netflix, like, immediately the first thing that it shows is, like, you know, hey, if you watch something, then because you watched this movie, I think you may be interested in, like, these other movies as well. And the huge advantage of AI is that there are, like, two significant advantages. One is it's very personal. And second thing is it's scalable. So it's scalable in the sense that once you build a machine learning model, you can use that model for almost, like, free cost to serve as many number of consumers as you want. Whereas, let's say, if you think of, like, a human, let's say there's a human in the bank, and then, like, you know, there's somebody goes to them to take an advice, or, like, there's a teacher, and then, like, you know, you ask the teacher, like, you know, the humans, they have like a scalability issue in the sense that like, you know, they can only serve like so many people. Unfortunately, we don't have the technology to clone ourselves. So we are limited by that capability. Whereas cloning a machine learning model is almost comes at a free of cost. So once we build a model, we can clone that model and that model can serve any number of billions of users. Another thing is like it becomes very personal. So let's say you have a teacher and you have like, you know, maybe 100 students in the class. Because we are human, by our like, you know, and we have like limitations in the sense that the teacher cannot know about every personal aspect of every student, like, you know, how they learn, what do they like, what way do they like, what's the sort of their routines, when do they want the content to be, what sort of like, you know, personal like learning style do they have. It's almost like impossible for the teacher to know. Whereas like, let's say if you have an AI teacher, it can learn, it can feed on the data about the student. Given enough data, the model can learn about the student in a very personalized way. They know about very specific things. So as an example, let's say you have a theater and there's a movie that's going on in the theater and there's an advertisement that is posted outside the theater. And that advertisement is like pretty static in the sense like, you know, once you post it, there's a poster of the movie, it doesn't change much. Whereas when you log in into Netflix, let's say you like an action scenes, whereas like your friend, they like maybe like in a cars. The same movie, when Netflix shows you, let's say like there are both action scenes and then there are cars, then Netflix makes a personalized poster for you, which is comes of maybe like, you know, the Vikings, like, you know, where it shows an action scene. Whereas when your friend logs in into Netflix, it shows him or her the, like, you know, maybe the car chasing scene, etc. So in that sense, this becomes like very personal. And that in turn helps, like, you know, getting giving a much better experience to the user. And again, like Netflix uses like AI heavily. And if you look at like both Amazon and Netflix, over 30% of the revenue they generate is from their AI based machine learning models. So which means that if you don't have AI in either Amazon or like Netflix, the company will be valued at 30% less. So imagine the amount of like impact. And today in the like, you know, age of COVID-19, like, you know, where just a few percentage, like even like, you know, being 4 or 5% less profitable means like, you know, matter of like, you know, life and death, a 30% matters like hugely. So in that sense, like, you know, if a company is using AI versus like if a company is not using AI, then the company that is not using AI will certainly go extinct. So that will open up like, you know, so that tells you how important AI is. And some other applications of AI is in like education. As you all know that, like, you know, teacher has like their own limitations. They can't deeply know like each and everybody. So whereas like a personalized teacher, they can get the right content for you. And there is no limitation of like how much the AI can know. It's basically like, you know, it can know like infinite or like, you know, pseudo infinite amount of like knowledge, and based on like what you want at what moment, they exactly can cater that. To banking and finance, there are possibly like, you know, huge, I think like, you know, one of the speakers is talking about AI is the finance industry is where like the paramount importance to security is. And today a lot of companies, they are looking at like, how can I reduce my risk? How can I like, you know, reduce the fraud detection? How can I increase the fraud detection? How can I improve my compliance regulatory reporting, and how can I do my like, you know, better prediction, etc. So I will give you like one scenario. Previously, let's say like, you know, let's say like if you want to go to bank and apply loans, you might have applied for loan for let's say 10 lakhs, 15 lakhs, etc. So for that, like, you know, one employee from bank, they can come to your home, and then or like, you know, they can come. Maybe you might have used a security for that. Let's say you're like in a home, or like there's a land, a piece of land. So a bank employee can actually physically go to that place and then verify the documents or verify the actual property and then give you a loan. But like, you know, using AI, new sort of like opportunities open up. For example, like, you know, just by logging up, installing the application, like banking application on your phone, the bank can go through all sorts of assets that you have. Let's say like, you know, who are your contacts, who is in your social network, what kind of like tweets you send out to, what sort of like, you know, apps you have, how do you spend the time on your like, you know, phone? Do you spend your time playing games, or do you spend your time maybe like, you know, learning educational content material, etc. So based on these factors, they can even give a loan of like, you know, 1 lakh or even like 10,000. So that gives like a huge, I mean, like now you can personalize the loans, and it also gives the bank a huge leverage to figure out like, you know, who can pay the loan faster versus like who can probably going to go default. And some of the biggest other applications of AI in today's world is about like knowledge graph. Essentially, knowledge graphs is all about representing knowledge in a very structured way. Let's say if you go and like read on internet or like different blogs, there is like a lot of knowledge embedded there. Like, you know, Wikipedia has like tons and tons of information. No matter what topic is of interest to you, you can go and look up that. But however, building these machine learning models, they require very structured knowledge. So, and AI is like using, like today people are using AI to build those structured graphs so that they can build even more knowledge graphs. So one of the examples was that like at Nike, we built a knowledge graph to capture all the information, how many shoes have been released, which shoes have been released, who was the project owner, how many people worked on this project, who are the people who worked on the project, what kind of material was used for the shoe, what sort of color was it, where was it released, when was it released, what kind of events happened during the time. So all kind of things. By using these kind of structured information, we were able to answer very complex query that helped us significantly boost the portfolio that Nike has. And specific companies, different companies have different knowledge bases. For example, Monsanto, they are hugely into agriculture and stuff. So there we were looking more at how can we build better genome database, analysis, etc. And right now this is being extensively used by some of the financial companies and research arms. And I would say one of the hugely important breakthrough that AI has done is in the data centers. As you all know that data centers consume, you might be knowing that data centers consume about 2 to 4% of whole world's electricity. And Google has come up with this actual AI algorithm, which can optimize, save about 50% of the data centers energy. So that has a huge impact. Imagine saving 1% of our world's electricity usage. That has that can save, means it can reduce the temperature of globe by at least 0.2 or 0.3 degrees Celsius, which is a huge boon for climate change. To large number of these companies are using AI for AI drug discovery, and especially now in the age of COVID-19, companies are left and right looking to how they can significantly speed up drug discovery, because in these scenarios where the time is of essence, as I said, humans have the scalability limitations in the sense that we cannot work 24/7, and also let's say once somebody is trained in this genomics or any of this drug discovery, etc., it's very hard to clone a person. It's very hard to train people, whereas once you train a machine learning model, it's very easy to scale up this model. So a lot of people are looking at how can they build better vaccines, drugs for combating these kind of bio challenges that we have using AI. Agriculture, when I worked at Monsanto, we had over 50 AI applications. And the goal of these 50 plus applications was to increase the productivity of the user by 30%. And we did that by building these several machine learning models. So for example, what time to plant the seed, meaning by are the weather conditions right? There is a machine learning model which tells, hey, this is the right time to plant the seed, and where to plant the seed. It analyzes the soil and then it says hey, this is the best location. And even let's say there is a tractor that is seeding the plants, and the tractor will look at the soil, and on site it will determine that, hey, given the soil is it's like a black soil versus a red soil versus it's a bit rocky soil, it will dynamically select the type of the seed that needs to plant, and that will give you around 1.5% extra boost for the whole agriculture yield. So by using 30 such, by using 50 such models with the whole company, it was able to bring up the yield of farming by about 30+%. To when to when to supply fertilizers, to how much quantity the fertilizer should be supplied, to how to route the vehicles for harvesting, seeding, etc. How to even when should we harvest, how to store. So all these kind of decisions were taken by complex AI machine learning models. And human resource HR has been HR is another field where AI is hugely impacting. to get started with, like, how do you assess the personality? Like, you know, given it like a candidate, how do you assess the personality of the candidate and figure out which department or, like, you know, which what field they might be suitable? Like, you know, are they extrovert? Like, meaning by, like, you know, do they like talking to people, and do they like maybe, like, you know, so does it mean, like, you know, let's say given a person is extrovert, they will be, like, much better suited for, like, you know, sales, marketing, etc. Versus a person is, like, introvert, they might be better at, like, building a product. So by using AI, companies are looking to see how they can, like, you know, assess the personality of their applicants, and then, like, you know, better group, put them in, like, a much at a better place where they can succeed. To even, like, job matching, given the skills, like, which is the best job in the whole company. Let's say if there is a typical HR person, then they may not know about all the existing possible jobs, whereas, like, AI, it can go through, like, these thousands and thousands of jobs across the company and figure out, like, which is the best matching job for the candidate. A is being even, like, applied heavily to smart grid and renewables today, to sort of, like, you know, how do we optimize this smart grid to bring down the energy consumption significantly? And companies like Google and Microsoft has done good amount of, like, research where they say that, like, you know, by using AI, we can at least bring it down by 15% to 20%, which will be, like, a huge boon for the renewable sector, given how the climate change is playing out. Healthcare, a lot of companies like Stanford, Google have done huge amount of research in this area. Let's say, like, you know, just if you take the COVID-19 scenario, right now we are short, we have, like, a huge shortage of doctors who can diagnose these, like, you know, various diseases. Let's say, like, you know, imagine, like, we have an AI machine learning model and, like, a machine which can diagnose, like, hundreds to thousands of patients a day, which that would mean, like, you know, that would have put down, like, a lot of pressure and would have saved more lives. This exactly has not been, like, a science form. This hasn't come to a science form yet. So people are still trying to figure out. But in the very near future, we will have, like, machines that would be able to diagnose. Let's say the patient goes in, the machine takes, like, you know, maybe the, like, one of the nurse, they take, like, samples, they take all the radios, they take all the, like, you know, x-rays and all sort of, like, you know, readings, and then the machine will diagnose in the back end, like, you know, what sort of diseases do they have, what sort of, like, you know, medicines do they need to be given to, what kind of, like, food they need to eat, what sort of, like, you know, personal care they need to be taken care of. And in general, like, you know, not only, like, you know, just diagnosing diseases, but in general, detecting lung cancer, to assessing the cardiac, like, health, to skin lesions, to detecting diseases in the eye. And even, like, you know, like, what sort of, like, drugs, etc., like, what sort of, like, medicines do the person need to take, AI is being used in all these people. Again, like, genetics is, like, it's sort of, like, you can think of it like either like a song or like a huge, like, long sentence. And these NLP, NLU technologies are being applied to better understand the genetic structure, to figure out, like, what proteins are, like, responsible for what, and how can we build better medicines for, like, a next, like, in the next generation, coming generation. Protein folding is another area which is, like, super complex. Given a protein like this, it can possibly fold in, like, billions and zillions of ways. And, like, the way a protein folds has, like, a huge implication on, like, you know, what sort of, like, medicines work, what sort of, like, medicines doesn't work. For example, like, in order to better understand how a COVID-19 protein works, if you understand how the protein folds, then we can better, like, you know, target the drug by having better, like, medicines. So, this is another area where there's a huge amount of, like, work going on in the field of AI. So far what we have discussed, like, you know, to some extent, they were, like, mostly, like, engineering challenges, but AI also has been crossing into the realm of, like, art, where it's not science, it's more like art, I would say. Like, you know, it's there is no, like, precise answer. Like, for example, like, given a painting, like, if you want to paint, let's say, like, you know, given a maybe like a mathematical formula, there is one and only one way to solve the, like, mathematical problem, like, most of the times. Whereas, like, an art is like an open-ended question. There is no right answer. There are, like, infinitely, like, correct answers. For example, like, given a canvas, you can paint the canvas in infinitely different ways. And this is where, like, AI has been, like, you know, making huge strides. These models are called GANs, Generative Adversarial Networks. Given a picture, like, let's say, I'm sure, like, you all have taken, like, these, like, you know, the fancy photos, like, you take your photo and then, let's say, maybe, like, you take this picture of, like, you know, Van Gogh, and then you try to match them. Like, essentially, it takes a picture of, like, a famous things like Picasso, Van Gogh, etc., and then takes the style from that picture, and it takes your picture, and then it applies that style to your picture. And this has been like hugely revolutionary, and art has been becoming in that sense like, you know, more like modern and like digital. It's becoming like digital. Not only art, like, you know, even like, you know, deep fakes. For example, like, you know, one here is like a real picture, and this is like actually a picture that is produced by AI. So in the future, you can imagine yourself like, you know, suiting up in like maybe like Iron Man, like, you know, costume or like a Hulk or whatever it is. You don't need to go and like, you know, put you up. Like, you just need to take a picture and then say like the AI algorithm will give you a picture like that. And some of the unfortunate things that are also happening is like, you know, AI also, like, people are using AI to create like fake news. And this possibly is like one of the biggest threats to the democracy today. And we need, and people are actually doing good amount of research on how to combat this fake news. This, like, you know, generating new text has both like good and bad side. For example, let's say like, you know, given a storyline, you may want AI to generate the story for that. And this can be used like, you know, helpful. This can be immensely helpful. Maybe say there is a kid who wants, like, you know, my kid complains every day that, like, you know, he wants like news stories, but I can't keep coming up with like news stories. Whereas the AI model can, like, you know, keep on generating these like new stories, and then, like, you know, tell me so that I can narrate that game. Whereas, like, you know, but so that's the good side. Whereas the bad side is that, like, you know, it can also keep on generating the fake news, especially in the era of, like, you know, Trump and, like, you know, where there's like so much hostility between, like, you know, people. This fake news can do like, you know, huge amount of like damage. So people are like looking at how can we combat this fake news using AI. There is also this very interesting, like, you know, application called NSynth, which is called like a neural synthesizer. I'm sure like you are all aware of like what is called a synthesizer. So it essentially combines two music instruments. Let's say like, you know, somebody is playing drums, somebody is playing flute. Then you can combine them. But when you combine them using a synthesizer, it essentially only adds. It's like, you know, I'm speaking and like there is also somebody else speaking. So you're playing drums and you are also playing like a flute at the same time. Whereas by using a neural synthesizer, you can sort of like imagine that, like, you know, hey, maybe like the drums and the flute got married and they have like, you know, cute like different baby, and imagine like how that baby sounds. It's neither the flute nor the drums. It's something in between that. It's essentially in the sense that it's a completely different instrument which has the properties of both. So I'm sure you all heard of like, you know, maybe the sounds of like, you know, Hulk or like, you know, in the Avengers, when the Hulk shouts, it's completely like unnatural. So there's no natural sound for that. Even like, you know, when you watch some of the movies like dinosaur movies, etc., some of these dinosaurs, the sounds that these like dinosaurs, these artificial like, you know, animals make sounds, they are not natural. They are created by using like, you know, something like this. So these machine learning models have like huge impact in the coming days of like, you know, media and entertainment. We are going to see like, you know, very different like, you know, angles and aspects to it coming in the future. Another big thing that's like, you know, everybody is talking about is like, you know, driverless cars, and sort of like, you know, why it will be a game changer is like, you know, in the tomorrow's world is like, you know, today possibly like billions of people, like, you know, at least like not billions, like thousands of people die in accidents every day. And even like, you know, billions of dollars and rupees worth is lost in those like accidents, to litigations, to court cases, to health, like, you know, issues that result from those accidents. Having a driverless car will mean like it will completely eliminate those, or like to large extent it will eliminate that, and then make travel very safe. Not only it will make it very safe, once we master the driverless cars, then it will be like, you know, you will have like, you know, Uber cars without a driver that can take you from anywhere to anywhere. And that's going to change the whole landscape of the cities. And we also need to like, you know, watch out for the secondary and the tertiary effects of these driverless cars, meaning by like, you know, people will drive longer, people will do like more things in car. Maybe like, you know, they board the car and then they will go to like a cafe and they will have their breakfast in the car on the way to office. And they might also watch a movie like on the way back to home, or like they may have like a meeting in the car itself, et cetera, et cetera. And today, even like AI is going to open up like completely new possibilities. For example, like, you know, things, the component that you are looking at here is a component that was designed here. The component was designed completely by using AI. And this component was thought previously to be like almost impossible due to like, you know, the human mind, limitations of human mind. We thought that this is almost impossible, but AI made it possible. And here on the right, you can see that this was a chassis for a car that is for a race car that is designed by AI, which is like, you know, it looks like very crazy, but when they compare the strength of this versus to like a normal, like, you know, Ferrari and these cars, this chassis had like, you know, more efficient, and it was like, you know, less, it's much stronger, and it was like, you know, less weight as well. So A is like, you know, going into the places where traditionally were reserved for like humans, like art, music, design, etc. And slowly, slowly, it's opening up into like, you know, areas of like, you know, management. So right now, let's say there's a meeting that's going on, and whatever the manager says, like, you know, that's sort of like, you know, the final decision. Like, you know, whoever has the highest salary, like, you know, whatever the decision that they take, like, that becomes like, you know, the decision that everybody else has to follow. But that need not be the right decision. So we are kind of like moving more and more towards like data-driven management. So it's mostly like, you know, right now where we are seeing a huge impact is like, you know, automating the routine administrative work that people are doing again and again, maybe like looking at the application and figuring out like, you know, hey, can this candidate be given a loan or not? So we are there, but slowly, slowly, I'm sure like, you know, one day we will have like an AI president or like an AI prime minister where like, you know, we are driven not by like religious sentiments, not by like, you know, affection to one group, but we will be driven by like, you know, essentially like the data. If you look at like the whole, everybody, like the data of like all the people in the country, and then it will make decisions possibly based on like, you know, hey, this is best for like these people. That comes to sort of like towards, that brings me towards the end, like, you know, so once AI becomes like almost human, like, you know, if AI becomes capable of doing everything that the human is capable of doing, then what does that mean? Like, you know, then let's say like, you know, somebody, imagine like an alien comes, like, you know, and they look just like us, they think just like us, and they are capable, like, you know, to think, to walk, to dream just like us. Now, what does that mean? Like, you know, do they have the same rights? Are like, you know, like, are they more than us? Are they less than us? And even like, you know, sometimes they may even like, you know, dream more. So, and also like, you know, we are facing like a lot of different issues. For example, like in a machine learning, like Microsoft trained a machine learning model that was bought on Twitter. And like, you know, it's essentially like, you know, when the machine learning model encapsulates the essence of the data that you feed it. And what happened is like, you know, a lot of people talk like a lot of racist things to it. And then like, you know, no matter what people say, it started like, you know, making all the racist comments. So how do we contain this thing? So how do we feed the right data to it so that like, you know, it becomes like a ethical bot? And governments are exploring how to build drones. And when we build a drone that is intelligent, then how do we make sure they don't go evil? How do we make sure they don't go rogue and they don't have like, you know, like today, let's say if there is a human soldier on the other side, even though they are like enemy, they have these concepts called like, you know, mercy to like, you know, humanity, etc. Whereas these drones, how do they like, you know, do they even have those things? Like, how do we make sure like these drones are like, you know, battle elements have the concept of like humanity? And imagine like a future where there's an AI salesman and they know the deepest fears, like just by looking at you, like, you know, by your facial expression, they can sort of like, you know, innately like know like, you know, what sort of like, you know, your deepest desires to deepest fears. Then actually, if they start using that for like bad, then what does that mean for us like in humanity? Like, you know, then they will be able to sell like, you know, whatever they want to us. Like, you know, we will have no ability to say no because like, you know, they essentially control our fears and desires. So in that sense, like, you know, there will be a huge struggle for like, you know, power and control. Then AI becomes like, you know, equally like powerful, and people are looking at like having a dialogue on like, you know, what sort of like ethics we need to capture, like, you know, how like, you know, we need to build this model so that they can be safe and as well as they can be like, you know, productive as well. With that, like, I would like to end this presentation by like, you know, by asking like, you know, a few questions. I want you to think of like, you know, by asking a few hypothetical questions. Let's say tomorrow we build a stitching machine and that is capable of doing stitching. And imagine like, you know, the whole country of Bangladesh, about 50% of the women population there is dependent on stitching. Just give me 1 minute. So a huge chunk of the population in Bangladesh is dependent on like stitching. Let's say tomorrow we build a stitching machine that is capable of outperforming human, like at less cost. It can do much better designs and it doesn't complain about like labor rights. It doesn't complain about salary. It works 24/7. It doesn't complain how hot it is. It doesn't complain that it's not getting water or like, you know, it doesn't get sick. So out of the blue, like the half of the population in Bangladesh, like women population in Bangladesh are going to get doubled. a driverless car, like let's say tomorrow we have an Uber driver that's completely autonomous and can take you from anywhere to anywhere, safety. You don't need to worry about like, you know, hey, whether the, like, you know, I have a lot of cash in my like pocket, whether that Uber driver, like, you know, he's going to rob me. You don't need to worry about those kind of things. But now, like, all of a sudden, a huge chunk of the population in India are going to be out of their jobs. So what does that mean for a typical driver who drives a car? And imagine a scenario where Google and Facebook, like having, like, you know, being completely driven by these machine learning algorithms, they go bad. What does it mean for you and me? Like, you know, we have stored like pretty much like everything that we know. There's a saying that, like, you know, Google and Facebook probably know us better than like, you know, the best friend or like, you know, even spouse. So what does it mean, like, if these companies go bad or like they get bought up by AI entities, and then, like, you know, will they be able to control the human, like, you know, the whole population? And also, like, you know, is AI artificial is not only like, you know, a machine learning model is not only intelligent, it's also like stupid. Like, you know, let's say, like, you build a machine learning model sometime, there's a joke that saying, like, if you build a machine, somebody built a machine learning model to make human happy, and you know what it did? It completely, like, you know, it kept giving them the drugs so that, like, you know, to make them happy. So how are we going to, like, you know, control this artificial stupidity? Is like natural stupidity not enough? And with AI, one of the huge changes that's going to happen to society is, like, you know, money is going to become equal to intelligence. Right now, they, like, you know, whoever is intelligent, they have a chance of becoming better, and they have a chance of becoming, like, you know, to grow up the ladder and to, like, you know, to hard work. Whereas, like, you know, let's say tomorrow with money, let's say if you have money, then you can go and buy this AI knowledge, AI machine learning models, which means, like, you will be vastly more intelligent than a common person who doesn't have, like, that much money to buy. Then how does it, like, you know, change the balance between, like, you know, rich and poor? The rich will become like crazy rich, and the poor will be left with, like, almost nothing. So then we sort of, like, you know, bring to, like, you know, let's say if we build robots that are intelligent, and then we say, like, you know, hey, we build, like, you know, if the robots are intelligent and then they take over all the jobs, does it mean, like, do we have, like, universal basic income where everybody gets paid, like, monthly, let's say maybe, like, you know, a few thousands of rupees, and nobody needs to do a job? In fact, then, you know, nobody will have a job to do, because, let's say, like, you know, robots will take over. Humans will still have, like, things to do, but slowly, slowly, like, you know, we will be, like, you know, phased out. But one thing is for certain, like, you know, I want you to think of, like, you know, what augmented intelligence for everyone would be. And this is already a reality today. So, for example, maybe 10 years ago, let's say you wanted to go to, like, a certain place. Let's say you want to go from maybe here to, let's say, like, you know, Patna, or like to Mumbai, or like Delhi. Then you have to carry a physical map. In the, let's say you are driving in a car, then you have to carry, like, a physical map, and you have to ask everybody on the way. But whereas, like, with, like, Google Maps, like, you can pretty much, like, it, which uses, like, huge amount of, like, intelligence, AI, machine learning models, right from mapping the terrain to figuring out which road it is there, like, what is the traffic and all these kind of things, we can, like, significantly benefit in the sense, like, you know, with almost, like, with a significantly less effort, we can go from anywhere to anywhere by driving the car by using Google Maps. So this is just one example, and this is going to come, like, you know, every aspect of our human lives will be made better by using augmented intelligence. So which is coming, like, very soon.
So can we ask question from students?
Yes. So with that, like, yeah. So sort of, like, you know, that ends my presentation, and I would like to now open up the for the students. Yeah.
Yes, students. If you have any questions, you can raise your hands. Yes. Any question from any participant? Okay, sir, I have one question with me. Is artificial intelligence is able to help a networking also? Like, we are doing a networking through different manually, but nowadays, as artificial intelligence is a very hot technology, so is it possible to do networking through artificial intelligence?
Sure, yes. As I said, like, you know, just take the example of Google Maps. Let's say previously you have to drive around manually asking everybody and, like, you know, figuring out the directions, like, by using, like, a manual map. So today it's like artificial intelligence is helping you. You might have not realized it yet. So when you log in into LinkedIn, so the connections that are shown, like, are based on machine learning models. So these machine learning models, they essentially, like, based on your interest, the machine learning model will recommend you, like, you know, who are the best people to get networked with based on, like, you know, your area, to geography, to career, like, you know, what your aspirations are, like, to different like, you know, mentors, etc. So it is already there, and it's going to get better and better. We will see, like, you know, more and more of websites like LinkedIn, Facebook, etc., which will help us. In fact, like, you know, Facebook, I would call it like a networking tool. So it's not like professional networking, it's more like a sort of, like, you know, a friendly, like, you know, making, like, for more friends and etc. So it's already there and helping, and we are going to see more and more of this in the future.
Okay, thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Jetty sir to give the summary of this session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Naidu sir for taking out his time and delivering a very wonderful talk. So the presentations was very nice. So he has given the importance of AI, the applications of AI, then what is the AI ethics is required, and the last he mentioned about all the implications of AI once it comes into a reality. So on behalf of DY Patil College of Engineering, Akudi, I would like to thank Dr. Naidu sir for sparing his time and giving his valuable experience, what he has gained during his tenure of work. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Jethi. Thank you for this opportunity.